For the Black Tech Task Force, I wanted to convene a diverse range of people, talents and perspectives. The new organisation did not need to be full of techie people, rather people who have a vision of how to construct ethical and equitable futures. The first people to ask were people who have been doing the work in the area of bias and racial justice. People like Joyanne Boyce with her project Include, focusing on inclusive marketing, and Edson Burton, addressing politics and futurism through writing and film. So far, I've asked Joy, Edson, Zara, Jazz, and Denise to be part of the UK's first Black Tech Task Force. I'm happy to say Joy and Edson have both said yes. The Black Tech Task Force will tackle wider societal issues to highlight the fact that the fight against AI bias has more to do with the wider inequities in society rather than just technological solutions. This is a huge fight. However, lessons from the past may be relevant. And who else to speak to but an historian? What relevance do you think the history of Black struggle as it pertains to the slavery period and the period after that, you know, the civil rights period, what lessons can we learn from those struggles to fight our future fight against AI bias and discrimination?
Well, in some ways, where do you start? There is so much on the one hand to be inspired by, but also to pick up the baton and say, what went wrong? What things weren't achieved and what things do we need to address, which perhaps because they were confronting with major causes around the right to vote, the right to even be considered a human being, that some of our great leaders, Rosa Parks, Martin Luther King, Paul Stevenson in Bristol, didn't have a chance to consider at the time. One of the interesting things to bear in mind is that people of African heritage have always been the most surveyed and surveilled peoples that have experienced colonialism and slavery and oppression. If you were a slave on a plantation and you wanted to visit a relative or a family member on another plantation, you had to carry your papers with you. If you were a free person, whether you were born free or being manumitted, that is set free, then you had to have your proof that you were free. Otherwise, you could be taken and put back into slavery. Now, we also see, even in Bristol, you've got bills of sale with perfect descriptions of Jack or Toby or Caesar, whatever the names were, to say that this person's property had run away. So in many ways, in terms of controlling people, owning them, managing their movements was essential to that process. And this was done in the past, of course, with non-digital means, but now we have digital surveillance. Now we've moved into a period in which algorithms and other data sets can tell people where you are and what you're moving. We're in quite a dangerous time when we think about the lack really of access and knowledge and control we have of that, especially if race and racism remains, as it still is, a factor in our lives. So I think what we need to think of is that actually we're in a continual struggle around freedom, freedom of movement, freedom to be, and how, in a sense, we are facing a new challenge with that. So in many ways, we could say that some things have improved. There is greater vigilance around rights, people can vote and so on. But there's another aspect that's going on. There's a huge development in terms of digital knowledge, digital surveillance. Who has access to it? And what's that access being used for?
You know, there are a wide range of technologies that my colleagues and I at the ACLU are paying attention to and worried about. You know, I focus on police surveillance issues and police investigative issues and trying to largely to try to figure out how to make sure the more than two century old Fourth Amendment to our Constitution that tries to constrain police searches still can apply in the face of technologies that police never could have imagined and that the framers of the Fourth Amendment never could have imagined centuries ago. So that includes things like police access to people's sensitive historical location information, whether it's the information generated by use of our cell phones stored by phone companies or police use of their own devices that mimic cell phone towers and secretly can track and identify and locate people's phones. Thinking about police use of automated license plate readers, which are deployed around cities throughout the United States and many other countries, and that record photos of every passing car and then transfer or transmute the photograph into machine readable text, stamp it with a geotag and a date, so there's a GPS coordinate, and then feed into these humongous billions of data point databases that end up generating just really accurate records of where people are driving over the course of days and months and years, again, giving police access to really sensitive information.
Recently, I read Atlas of AI by Kate Crawford. She said, it's time to stop talking about AI ethics and start talking about power. As ordinary citizens, Black people, how do we have influence over corporations, over transforming society? What do you think we have to do to gain this power and to make that power sustainable?
I think it's around being at the table, being embedded and part of, fully participating in this new movement around digital knowledge and data. So that, in a sense, the danger is that we're left behind,
yes,
and that we're being asked to kind of integrate into or find our place within this new culture. And it's expanded rapidly. And I think we look at social media, for example, we've all beginning to recognize just how much it transformed, not just society, but how we map the world cognitively.
One of the first challenges for the Black Tech Task Force is to push for regulation regarding black box technologies. What's the progress on black box technologies?
Other colleagues of mine are thinking about issues involving police use of black box algorithms to try to, for example, identify different people's DNA from mixed samples. So you might have a crime scene where a forensic investigator thinks this is a DNA sample, but it's not one person. It's at least two or three or four or five. And it is a very difficult task to try to figure out whose DNA that is, because it's all just mixed together. And a couple of private companies have purported to create these algorithms that can probabilistically assess what the different contributors are there. But those algorithms are secret. They are of very dubious accuracy. And so we've done a bunch of work, colleagues of mine have, trying to make sure that people accused of crimes and their lawyers can try to actually get access to the underlying algorithm and the data to figure out if it's accurate, because the ramifications of being falsely identified through a shadily assembled DNA quote unquote match are just devastating if you're accused of a crime. Other colleagues working on issues around use of algorithms to make bail and bond determinations or supervised release determinations to try to predict future dangerousness. Questions around use of kind of a new generation of really dodgy lie detectors that rely on recording people's eyes and purporting to be able to tell based on blink rates and eye movements whether someone's telling the truth or not, which as best we can tell is complete pseudoscience, but of course has tremendous ramifications for someone, for example, on probation or parole, who's being interviewed by a probation officer, and are they going to get sent back to jail because an algorithm says that they're not telling the truth? There are just so many places where data is able to be used and manipulated in ways that are very hard to understand because it's based on some inscrutable black box machine learning algorithm that nobody can actually understand.
At the moment, a corporation can build an algorithm and be totally opaque and non-transparent about how it's built. They disown the results or the effects of their technology. So even though that technology will cause great social harm, they're not accountable. That needs to change. So this is our call to action, our 10-step plan to build an ethical future. These steps are not exhaustive. We know the work is vast, but we have to start somewhere. Number one, start from where you are. You don't need any special knowledge or skills. Number two, see who else is doing the work. See what else is needed and how you can help. Number three, read and research your chosen area or field thoroughly. The more you know, the better. Number four, take self-care seriously. If you don't look after yourself, no one will. Number five, be innovative. create new solutions or new ways of doing or looking at things. Number six, take people with you. Build sustainable communities and join with others whenever you can. Number seven, fundraise creatively. You may be able to find resources in diverse places. Number eight, be generous. Share your time and don't forget to share your wins. Nine, protect yourself online. Disclose very little to no personal information and audit your security regularly. Number 10, delete Facebook. Stop making money for big tech companies and disrupt their engagement model. This hasn't been so much of an investigation as much as an innovation. Once the problem of bias became clear, I got on with the building. My answer to this problem was to just get on and build the ethical future I want to see. It's been an amazing journey. 8 months ago, these were just dreams and ideas. And now, we not only have a fully fledged project, we have a legacy institution to safeguard the future, protecting the rights of those who are not in a position to do that for themselves. We also have the UK's first Black-led, eco-friendly NFT platform in the works, and a voice in the conversation of reframing the past regarding historically enslaved peoples responsible for the wealth of nations. There's still so much more to do. This is just the beginning. Welcome to the Black Tech Task Force. So we're 5 years in the future. Tell me what's changed.
Organisations like the Black Tech Task Force, and that's brought so much positive change.
Well, it's so much better than 5 years ago. We've really come a long way.
I get my reparation basic income every month.
I got my reparation through my pension.
If we want a future that looks like us, we have to build it.